I'm going to hand it over to Carolyn and to Matt. Welcome.
Thank you. This is my baby, which I did last year. And I was lucky enough to get Craig Lee to do the photos. This is a compilation of about 54 of the Bay Area's top chefs, their stories and their recipes. And of course, it includes the gentleman standing right here, Chef Matt Accarrino of SPQR. So I know that you guys know that Matt is an incredible cook, but what you might not know is exactly how he came to be cooking as a chef. So he's a very sporty guy, and when you were a teenager, you had an accident playing sports, and it was actually a fortuitous thing because they discovered a tumor in your leg that was benign, but had you not had the accident, they probably would have never discovered it. So he had surgery, and it was a really long ordeal to recover it. Basically, you had to learn how to walk over 2 years. And I want you to kind of tell everybody how Emeril Lagasse kind of changed the path of your life during all of this.
Sure. Well, first of all, you glorify it by calling it a sports accident, because I actually wanted to be a professional cyclist. So I was thinking in my mind, this is what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to ride 500 miles a week on my bicycle. I'm going to go to France. I'm going to race in the Tour de France. I'm playing frisbee outside of high school. Jump up, catch it, land, and this sort of benign tumor that had been growing in my femur since birth, so I get taller, it gets bigger, breaks. Next thing I know, I'm on the ground, on the way to the hospital, the worst pain I've ever felt in my life, the whole ordeal. And so, you know, I remember right before they put me out, they said, so there's like a 60% chance that you'll wake up and your leg won't be there. And I was thinking,
oh,
I'm 16
gosh.
Years old. What are you talking about? And I wake up, thank God, leg's still there, can't walk for 2 years. So all I do is sit around the house and watch TV. What am I gonna eat next? They basically have nothing else to do. So I got interested in cooking. It was something I could do. It was something that I could actually do without leaving the house, without going somewhere else.
Because you're watching a lot of cooking shows on TV.
So Jacques Pepin, Julia Child, and of course, this is right around the early 90s, the birth of the Food Network. Emeril Lagasse is on there doing whatever he was doing. And I go, wow, this guy's pretty interesting. I'll write him a letter and see, maybe he'll get back to me. Gets back to me immediately, which is amazing. And something that I always keep to heart now when I get letters and things like that from young students and people that want to learn to cook, and have oftentimes opened up my kitchen to people, because he immediately said, you know, why don't you come down to New Orleans and hang out in the kitchen? So next thing you know, I'm in New Orleans cooking with Emeril Lagasse.
And you were how old?
18.
Wow. So what sorts of things did he have you doing in his kitchen?
Well, I mean, he turned me loose. There was this guy, Mr. B, who used to make these banana cream pies. It was like the best banana cream pie I've ever had in my entire life. All these different guys. There's so many different things going on. I was so new to cooking at the time that it was, you know, what I always tell the people that work for me now is that if you first start cooking, and the learning is absolutely exponential. You don't know anything. So every day you're learning this crazy amount of information. And then as you begin to get more experience doing something, you get a little higher on the mountain and you're not learning, you're learning how to do the same things better or how to do something in a different way. And maybe you're not learning something completely new. But what happened in that kitchen was eventually Emeril kind of came around to me and said, hey, you know, you're pretty good at this. You should really go see my friend Charlie in Chicago. I'm like, okay.
Charlie
Trotter.
It
would be Charlie Trotter. So.
But
I walk into the kitchen of Charlie Trotter, this sort of famous, very high-end restaurant in Chicago, and you know, everybody's got the French toques on and all these things, and I walk in and I go to the thing and there's a locker and it says Matthew Accarrino on the locker.
Wow,
and
that's pretty cool.
Pretty amazing experience at all of about 18 or 19 years old. So my cooking career kind of just moved from there and I never stopped. So I tried to go back to cycling for a couple of years, but I figured out that you know, I had sort of lost the momentum to you know, if you look at the great races, and actually I'm friends with a number of people that are professional cyclists today, and you know, it's like 10, it's like a lot of sports, your peak years are between, it's like 20, and I mean, I would be retired already, I'm 36, so you know, they talk about somebody being really old and they're 40 if they're cycling, so it was a fortuitous thing.
All of this happened, would you have considered cooking as a career?
Yeah, I always, even when I was a kid, I always said I either wanted to, well, I think it was three things. I wanted to, like, drive a train, you know, when I was, like, five.
Like every boy, yeah. Yes.
And then I wanted to ride bicycles, and I wanted to cook. So those were always my three things somehow. So I'm
assuming that you have seen Emeril in the years that have passed. What does he think now, seeing what you do?
I mean, I think he would think it's just like any other mentor. It's, you know, I've worked for so many chefs, Thomas Keller, Tom Colicchio, a variety of people. So I just won Food&Wine Best New Chef. And so I was in New York and I saw, you know, Tom Colicchio. And, you know, they're very proud because those are people that remember you back at that time when you did know nothing. And as you begin to know a bit more, I think they're proud to see you. And, you know, certainly they've all, Emeril included, conveyed that kind of
Has he eaten
message.
Your food?
Emeril?
Yes.
I don't think so.
What?
Not here in San Francisco.
Okay.
Yeah.
You got to do something about that. Got to invite him in or something. So today, you're going to make something out of your own cookbook.
Well, it's a variation. Yeah.
Okay. For springtime?
For springtime. And I wanted to share with you all a couple of different techniques and you know, to cover maybe some what to me might be more basic things, to you that might be completely brand new things. I don't know how experienced the cooking group we have here. So I have an acre up in Napa that I grow on for the restaurant and grow a lot of my own vegetables. Having been sort of born in the Midwest, grew up on the East Coast, and then eventually came out to California about 6-7 years ago, I'm very taken with, you know, sort of that farm to table, but beyond that to the next generation. So, you know, looking at how can I grow my ingredients? What, for instance, like this thing that I brought, I have all these calçot onions, which are the onions that they grow in Spain and they bury them in coals, if you've ever seen this, and cook and they peel the onion and eat it with romesco sauce. So it's very Tony Bourdain.
You're growing
kind
those?
Of thing. Yeah.
Oh,
but
cool.
They eventually go to flower like this, and the flowers are incredible. So I'll use those a little bit for a garnish today. And then we have some vegetables over here. We kept it pretty simple as far as spring vegetables go. So, some pearl onions right here, some peas, got some tarragon and parsley from the garden, asparagus, and then some carrots. So, one of the first things, so we're going to do some of the vegetable prep first, if that's okay.
Sure.
One of the first things about vegetables like carrots. So ideally, we're going to make this gnocchi in a little bit. And the gnocchi are all sort of uniformly the same size. And then you have this carrot, and it's sort of a lot fatter up here than it is down here. And so sort of how do you deal with that? And one of the first things they teach you in the French kitchen, or really just about any kitchen, is a cut called the oblique cut. And what that cut does is it's actually designed to even this whole situation out. So what you do is you start, peel the carrot, and you make a cut, turn it slightly, cut again, slightly, cut again. And every time I'm kind of rolling it towards me and making a cut, I'm producing something, but the diameter of this carrot is actually changing. And so you'll see that for something that started out fat at the top and slim at the bottom, if I now take this, and so we have one of those glass, all these cuts are now basically essentially the same size, right? So you guys can see that here. And this is sort of a really important thing as far as vegetable cookery goes, because if all these are gonna be the same size, that means they'll all cook the same. They'll all cook at the same time. And so no matter what I do with them, whether I roast them or I boil them, they're all gonna come out the same way. So, and it always amazes me to see those little things like that, because somebody had to think of that at some point and decide that that was a good idea. And I don't know who that was. Yeah, it was Paul Bocuse probably, who knows. So that's that. So we have the carrots, and so I've done that to some already. Asparagus is another thing. So what I like to do with my asparagus is actually take all these little eyes off. And I don't know if you guys have ever had asparagus and eaten them and found dirt in them, but especially when it rains, it makes sense. If this thing grows out from the ground like this, if you get a rainstorm halfway through this thing's life and it's only this tall, the water drops hit the dirt and the dirt jumps into these eyes and then it grows the rest of the way. By the time it's this big, if you just cook this thing, almost uniformly you'll find dirt.
Wow, I didn't know
food.
That.
So if you like the grit, don't worry about it. But for me, I'll go ahead and pick all these off and I can actually see little bits of dirt in these from when we had some rain, not a terribly long time ago, but we were pretty drought starved for a while.
Do you do the thing too where you snap it and where it breaks is the natural
point? And it's always good to know that. And we could tell just because I never let them grow that big. They only ever get about this big, but you know, eventually they'll get rather large. And so for these, we're just going to do these sort of 1-inch cuts and end up again with something that's relatively the same size as the carrots. The other one we have is some pearl onions. Pearl onions, just a nice, small, soft onion. I've already kind of peeled these. I'll cut them in half. And then what I like to do is just pull the stem end out. And then you can pop all the different layers out.
By the way, if you have Matt's cookbook, you know, and if you've eaten at his restaurant, you know he's very meticulous about his techniques. In fact, I always give him a hard time and he gives me a hard time back because I made this pasta dish from his book and I was balking at the fact that it required peeling cherry tomatoes, which you can imagine the undertaking, you know, that requires.
I'm a glutton for punishment.
Yes.
All right, then we have some peas. So I have all that stuff ready. Other things we're gonna use, some burrata cheese made with cow's milk here in California. Burrata cheese is kind of a pulled, what they call a pasta filata, a pulled cheese, kind of a pulled mozzarella, and then usually encased in a very thin layer of mozzarella cheese, but it has a nice creamy aspect to it. My family still live in Puglia in Italy, and it's interesting because the first time I went to go work in Italy, I worked in the north up in Milan, and so I thought I was doing this amazing thing by bringing them this beautiful Parmigiano that had been aged for 5 years, and only the red cows were the ones they milked to make this cheese. It was the most special thing. I went to Peck Market in Milan, which is an incredible gastronomic market in Milan. Bought this thing, got on the train, take the train down to Puglia, show up, hey, look what I got for you. And they go, that is garbage.
Oh.
You know? And it's because it wasn't from there. So it's from too far away.
Oh, yes.
We don't eat that. We don't really like it. But we do have this. And then they showed me burrata. This was like 15 years ago. So interesting. So
it was actually, it was the ingredients in California. That was one reason that brought you to the Bay Area?
Well, I actually worked for Thomas Keller.
At Per Se?
10 years ago.
You were opening sous chef there?
Opening sous chef, and they closed the French Laundry to bring all of the French Laundry staff here from California to New York to open that restaurant. And so I got to basically spend my entire day hearing all these French Laundry guys go, yeah, that's a nice artichoke, but if you were in California, you would see that it would be much nicer. And so it got relatively annoying after a while for an East Coaster like me.
I bet.
And so, but it definitely planted a seed where at some certain point I thought, I might want to go take a look and see what that's all about. So I was working for Tom Colicchio at the time, running restaurants for him in New York, and he came to me one day and said, I'm opening a restaurant in Los Angeles, what do you think? I said, sure. So next thing I know, I'm in Los Angeles. So and then eventually up to here, up to San Francisco. So, all right. Gnocchi. Gnocchi I would imagine to a lot of people is potatoes, flour, egg, and something you try to avoid making where it's heavy. This gnocchi is something completely different. So this is a semolina gnocchi. So we use semolina flour. It's one of the flours that I use to make pasta. All of the pasta that I serve at SPQR we make in the restaurant. So it's kind of a coarser durum wheat flour. So we use that. There's no potatoes in it. There's eggs. Somebody noticed there was butter in it before. And it's basically a pâte à choux style. So the same thing that you would use to make an éclair, or the same base they've used to make an éclair is what this base essentially is, but we add things like cheese and the semolina to it that's a bit different. There's no sugar in it.
Is it a little bit more forgiving? Because I know sometimes
it's completely
with
more,
potatoes,
not only is it more
it's
forgiving,
a little tricky.
But it's beyond a certain few things, it's actually very difficult to mess up in my, I would assert. So I have some flour, I have some water and some butter that's been brought to a boil here in this pot. And what I'm going to do is this is regular flour, and then you can see the color here, the difference between the white. This is the semolina flour, so it has a much coarser texture. You guys want to pass this around. Hopefully this won't mess up the recipe. So, I don't know if you want to start that down there, and they can see the difference between. And really, it's has to do with the milling of the flour. So this is very, very finely milled, and this is a bit more coarsely milled, but they're in some ways similar as far as being flours. So I've just added the regular flour to this as it's boiling, and then I'm gonna add now the semolina.
Are you getting your flour from Italy?
Some of it from Italy, yes. We use 00 flour, but 00 is really refers to a grind, so it's a very fine flour, but any all-purpose flour will be fine. So, and really when they're talking about all-purpose flour, they're talking about a flour that's been balanced in terms of the gluten content and the amount of protein in it, so that you can do a lot of different things, which means you could make biscuits with it and pancakes, but you could also make bread with it. So you'll notice that because the water was boiling, this begins to thicken up and it turns into this sort of paste, and that's exactly what we want.
And then
this one is all the way at the highest. But it has to be enough. The crucial element is that it's enough to boil the water. And then, because it really requires, and what's happening in this is that the starch has gelled. The same way if you make polenta, this is that same kind of technique. So what's happened is the starch that's there in the flour has gelled because of the temperature of the water boiling. And that's created a structure, and that structure is what we're gonna harness to make the gnocchi, and that's why they won't fall apart when we go in the water. So I turned it off now, and I just cooked it until it started to get a little bit shiny, and it's obviously very thick. Oh yeah, sorry. it's a force of habit. So I really stress that a lot with the people that cook for me, is that level of attention to detail and organization, because if you're always doing that, then we'll tend to run these containers through the dish machine, and then they're all back in one location. And so if I ever go back there and see the tape on them, it's like, you know. I physically can't walk past it without taking the tape off. So, but then eventually they all get to be the same way, so, which is helpful. So this is now ready. And what I'm gonna do is transfer this, and this dough is pretty hot at this point. So we're gonna put it onto the mixer and let it cool down a little bit. Carolyn, why don't you tell them about the process of writing your book and working with all those chefs.
Oh my God. Well, it was quite the process, because I was only given 3 months to do the book. And so I really relied on chefs like Matthew to meet a deadline that I forced upon them. And thankfully, I didn't nag you too much, right?
I don't remember any nagging.
Okay, that's good. So it was great that he was very clear on what he wanted to do, and the fact that I wanted recipes that were home-cooked friendly, which most of his recipes thankfully are, because you know what can be done at home, and you know what is best done in a restaurant kitchen.
Yeah, that's always, I've always found that that's a difficult balance, because people are always asking me to give them recipes that are home-cooked friendly. Like this one, I tried to make as friendly for you guys as it could be, so that actually you might make this. But my job as a chef, in my eyes, is to make something you can't make.
Exactly.
Otherwise,
that's
why would you come see me?
Right? Yeah.
What good would I be to you?
Uh-huh.
Right. So
it's got to be worth the money of going out, right?
So.
What else could be?
You could do it by hand even. You'll be tired at the end, but.
Yeah. Don't go to the gym, just make this instead. Yeah.
But so you notice I'm just kind of pausing to let this cool a little bit, and then these are some of the carrots and the peas and things that I talked about before, and they've all just been quickly blanched.
So you come from a long line, I'm assuming, of very good Italian cooks. Is your heritage?
Yeah, it was amazing. For my 26th birthday, I went to visit my family, and so my aunt Colombina has this olive ranch up in the hills outside of a town called Manfredonia, and it's beautiful. It's like the absolute most picturesque place that you're looking out over the ocean. Manfredonia is a town of about 60,000 people, or a small city of about 60,000 people, and they literally have the stone wheel with the donkey for the olives, and then, you know, we're going to make the oil, and so there's like a carob tree and wild capers, wild fennel, wild arugula. Somebody made potato donuts.
Potato donuts,
ciambella,
wow.
They call them, ciambella. So it was a pretty unique experience, but it also was, you know, basically everything that I had for my 26th birthday was sourced from within like 5 miles of that location. So that was an interesting birthday, to say the least.
So at SPQR, you know, people call it an Italian restaurant, but what you do is very unlike Italian recipes and dishes anywhere else.
Yeah, almost.
How
like
would
I'm,
you describe what you do there?
I would say I'm making American food at this point. You know, one of the things that I think, at least from my historical perspective, what it may be, is that there was a period where if you wanted to learn about cooking, the idea was, and if you could sort of rewind it back to like Paul Bocuse's, is the sort of father, French father of modern cooking, let's say, right? So then all these other people like Freddy Girardet and worked for Paul Bocuse. And then when all the people that were mentors to me, the Thomas Kellers, Tom Colicchios, right?
Rick Moonen,
right? Mm-hmm. All these people, they all went to France and worked for that second generation of guys that worked for Paul Bocuse and brought back those kind of recipes. But a lot of them in the very beginning were learning to make French food because that's what we thought the best food was. At some certain point, there were enough chefs, people like Thomas Keller, that said, wait a second, I can honor French food, but I'm American, so I'll make this. And then I kind of am the next generation of that chef, at least in my eyes, that now says, I have this Italian heritage, I embrace it, I'm inspired by it, but I'm American, I live in California, and nothing will make my food more Italian than growing some of my own food, being involved with those ingredients, learning how to make as many things as, you know, making them in-house and all those things at the restaurant. That makes my food more Italian than bringing all of my cheeses and condiments and all that thing from Italy, because just because you import it doesn't mean that you get the right to call yourself authentic, you know. And so I want to be authentically myself and authentically American. So I think I kind of get away with it, whether people call that an Italian restaurant. And I think there's all these, you know, it's interesting when you look at like the Zagat or the, everyone's trying to classify restaurants, and it used to be Italian, and then it was like Italian North and South, which I don't really know what that meant. And now we get dubbed modern Italian, so whatever that means. So it's actually, you know, the fact that people are grasping for terms to describe it is a good thing, because it means that we're doing something different. And you're pushing the envelope. And I think that's what good cooking is really about. And that's what I want to be doing every day. And I want to be doing with the people that are working with me. So,
was it a lot of pressure for you to step into the shoes of Chef Nate Appelman at SPQR, who was a huge name when he was manning the restaurant?
Yeah, you know, I was lucky enough to be somewhat insulated from it. I moved to San Francisco in 2009, and Nate had left 6 months prior to my arrival at the restaurant and had been the opening chef of the restaurant. And so when I got there, I really didn't know anything about it and immediately just proceeded to do whatever it is that I was gonna do. And so I've never really looked back at that. And so for me, it didn't make a difference. And I've always just guided myself off of doing what it was that I thought was important to me. So, and then I think for the people that knew the restaurant before, I guess it really bears no resemblance.
No,
so,
not at all, yeah.
Which I was probably, you know, as indicative of his style as it is of mine, that chefs have very different styles and can completely find our way of changing just about everything. So I've let this cool off a little bit, and then you'll see that as I start it, a little bit of the steam will come out. And then I have some eggs here. Now, to add the eggs in, I'm going to do them one at a time, and there's two reasons you want to do that. It will come out as a thicker batter somehow miraculously if you incorporate the egg one at a time. Secondly, if you put them all in at once, you'll wear it because it'll be everywhere. So we'll just start one at a time, and every egg that goes in will get incorporated. It gets a little bit looser for a second, and then it'll tighten back up. And so now we're sort of harnessing this gluten structure that we created by boiling it.
It's a lot of eggs in this.
So what happens is when the eggs poach in the water, between that gluten structure and the egg, it souffles a little bit.
Oh,
and that souffle
so
makes it really, really very fluffy and very light.
Because there's nothing worse than a very heavy gnocchi, right?
Yeah, so these are sort of impossibly light gnocchi. And the thing I like about this is this batter, once we make the batter, I actually invite you guys to come up, anyone who wants to, and pipe, because it's kind of a fun thing. It's a good technique to learn.
I didn't know you get to do that, huh?
But you can make the gnocchi. So today we're going to make it, and I'm going to pull it, and we're going to serve it kind of poached right from the water. You could actually make them ahead, let them cool, and then you can saute them. And they'll take color really, really nicely. So if you wanted to, I actually have a recipe for this in my cookbook where they're sauteed and there's a lamb ragu that they're served with. So something that would be maybe a little heartier.
How far ahead could you make them? Could you make them the day before?
You could make them the day before.
Freeze them and then
I've never frozen
later?
Them, but I'm sure you could. And see how it comes out. I mean, if you like it, you like it, right?
Sure. So
now all the eggs are incorporated, and then I have a little bit of cheese that we'll add. This is Parmesan. Same reason, I'll shut it off for a second so I don't. Right, otherwise, we'll.
So how old were you when you made pasta for the first time by yourself?
By myself?
Yeah.
I had to be in my teens, but I remember actually my third grade birthday party. My grandmother came from Boston and made pizza and pasta and all this stuff, and I had to make it all with her, which I thought was a horrible chore. And then I cried the whole day because I wanted Domino's.
Oh no.
That's what everybody else had at their at their pizza parties. Little did I realize I had basically a master. Making my so.
Exactly. We should all be so lucky for
that's
our
what
birthdays.
We get when we're young little brats, right? So we don't know any better. The cheese is sort of enough, and then I have seasoning in the water, so you guys will taste it and you'll see, but to me, you can add a bit more seasoning. I put a pinch of salt in the water before, I don't know if you guys... Yeah, herbs. You could add the chopped herbs right into the gnocchi. Any seasoning you want, dried herbs, like fennel pollen would be great in there, truffle, anything that tastes good. So actually, have you guys seen black garlic before? This black fermented garlic, so it's kind of everywhere now. I remember when Fanny from Le Sanctuaire showed it to me 7 or 8 years ago, and I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. And
now it's
at Whole Foods, yeah. So what I've actually figured out, and I was gonna show you guys, but I figured it'd kind of take a little long, and you need quite a bit to do it, but if you peel all the black garlic when it comes in the skins, we save the skins and put hot water over it and make kind of a black garlic tea. It seems wasteful to throw it out. And then we actually use that water, that infusion, with the black garlic and make a puree that really reinforces it. So I have a little bit of that, and then summer truffle season just started, so I brought a little summer truffle for you guys today. So those are some garnishes that are kind of optional. But yeah, a lot of things will work as fold-ins to this batter, and because you have this structure, you could put together any combination of seasonings that work for you, and I think there's probably a lot of things that this batter could actually hold within itself. So, and this is just, I actually had a German intern in my restaurant, and if you guys have ever seen this the gnocchi where they have it on a board and they use a spatula and they scrape the gnocchi into the water. You could actually do that with this dough, and that would be another way to do it. But I would imagine you could put like little bay shrimp into it or something and do that, and you know, it would be.
So, Chef, a lot of your mentors, Colicchio, Moonen, even Thomas Keller a little bit, have had a TV presence. Would you ever consider doing like Top Chef, Top Chef Masters, anything like that?
I've thought about it. You know, I've sort of been asked a couple of times, but maybe it's not my thing. I don't know. I really like the aspect of being in the restaurant and being with the customers, and I'm lucky enough that SPQR is a fairly small restaurant, and the kitchen is basically in the middle of the dining room for those of you who have been
there. It's a tiny kitchen,
yeah,
too.
And so I actually like that aspect where I'm really interacting with my customers, and you know, we have one of my great regulars. He's an older gentleman. He comes in every Saturday night. And I say every Saturday night, but he, I think it's his 300th visit.
Oh my God! Wow.
Something like that to the restaurant. So, this Saturday. So I'm getting something special ready for him.
Oh,
but
that's
like,
great.
Those are the things that make me really excited about being a chef and what I'm doing. Because you think about that, it's like, you know, that person that comes. I mean, he's literally there every Saturday. And he brings me either a New York Times or a New Yorker article to read. And so the only reason that I have any culture whatsoever
is because
or know
him.
What's going on anywhere any with anything will be because he brings me those articles and I read them. So, but those are to me, those are the great experiences. And another thing about cooking that has really been important to me is the ability to travel and to do things like being here today that add a life experience dimension to what I do. I've pretty much have not seen the entire world, but I've seen a lot of the world because I cook. And to me, that's been a really important thing and a really worthwhile thing. So
what's the best thing about being a chef?
I don't have to wear a suit when I go to work. I have the same uniform, right? I never have to worry about what I wear to work. I just put on the same chef coat, you know?
That's true.
Right?
That's
so I remember being younger and thinking like, wow, man, I never really want to have to like...
Put a tie on.
Yeah, worry about going to work like that. So it kind of worked out perfectly. But I think, honestly, some of the best things about being a chef is every day I'm creative and every day I see that creativity fulfilled. Because every day I'm making a dish, and even though there are things that take days and days to prepare, every day I finish something, you know? So every day, and we actually finish a lot of things. So it's a much faster cycle than going and looking at a piece of ground and saying, I'm gonna build a building here in 7 years. You know, in 7 years, I'll be able to look at my complete building. I can make that building, I can make this dish in half an hour. You know, and so I think that instant gratification is a great part about cooking, and also being able to work with all of the people that work in my restaurant with me, all of my staff, and being able to be a leader to people and a mentor to people, and to return some of the favors that were shown to me when I first started cooking. You know, seeing somebody go through and know nothing and eventually know something is pretty gratifying. So
conversely, what's the worst thing about being a chef?
The opposite of everything
the
I just
opposite
said.
Opposite of everything.
I mean, the hours are long. And the task is always arduous. So I think it's one of those things where sometimes it's one of those careers that, you know, people say the restaurant industry is very difficult. It's because it demands a lot and you always have to put into it. And I think there are a lot of careers that are actually like that. But you're only as good as your last meal. So you can never really, this way. Can never really rest on your laurels, as it were. So. The batter I transferred to the bag, and then I don't know if you guys noticed that, but this is a little trick that I do, because when I first started cooking, we used to have these canvas bags that you could use over and over again. We never use those anymore. We always use this, and I actually will rinse these out and reuse them, because I feel pretty terrible about throwing plastic in the garbage, because it basically goes nowhere. It goes to some landfill somewhere. So
if someone doesn't have the tip, could they just use a Ziploc bag and cut the end off?
Yeah. So, but these kind of tips, they're inexpensive. They only cost a couple dollars. They're a really good investment, as is this thing, which I use to flip things over in a pan, and you're going to see me use it to cut the gnocchi. Things like little, these are actually sewing scissors, Joyce Chen,
right? Oh my God, yeah. Really?
So we use these in the kitchen for a lot of things like that. And
what I'll do is, are you a big tweezer guy too?
I left them at home today.
Oh, for
you guys. So, but you know, what's funny is that the tweezers, that whole thing is really about if I'm trying to place a garnish into a dish, and my fat little fingers are gonna mess it up.
Or if you're shaking it all.
It's better to use a tweezer to do that thing. And so if you're really trying to make these elaborate presentations or elaborate constructions, sure, that thing is helpful, but I don't feel compelled to put every single thing that I touch on the plate with a tweezer, but it's definitely a helpful tool. I mean, it's just like anything else. Having, you know, the right tool for the job is a huge benefit. Because anything that you've ever tried to do where you didn't have the right tool and it took about 10 times longer because you didn't have that tool, you appreciate that, you know? It's like,
I'm sure they can relate,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah. So transfer this to here. And then if you got it to this point and you wanted to serve this and it was a dinner party, you just come back later.
Oh, okay.
So as long as you have the water ready. This is, you know, I mean, eventually there's eggs in here. It's, you know, you don't want to leave it out for a couple of days, or probably some kind of fermentation project would start in there. But you know,
could be a new thing,
for
right?
For an hour, it's fine. And uh-huh. So it's just lightly warm. And then basically I'm going to bring this over the simmering water. There's salt in here. And then what I figured out is you'll see if I'm tapping, I'll just start. Gentle pressure on this. And then you can sit here and just tap. And what's actually happening is I'm aiming for the tip of the bag, but the handle of the wood is hitting the pot. And so that's what's stopping it. You'll notice if it's like this, it's a little bit harder to hit this target for me.
Is there an ideal size for these?
Or? About 2 inches. And then eventually you could stop and sort of reassess where you're at. So I'll do a few more and then we'll open it up for somebody else to try. Nope, they'll stay just like this. So whatever size they go in here as, they'll stay. Yeah, this batter would be too loose to do that. So this is that totally different style of gnocchi that, you know, if you wanted it to be a little bit bigger, you could change the tip to a larger pastry tip, and that would give you a different style or a different size. So, who wants to try? Come on around.
So have you done this before?
Oh.
So, if I...
You can't mess it up. Yep, turn this one this way. Are you left-handed?
I'm right-handed.
So you might want to switch.
Yeah, I was like...
I'm left-handed,
okay.
Yeah. I won't handicap you. Yeah, so gentle pressure, and then whenever it looks long enough. Maybe you start to get... See how you have this on here? Just dip this in the water.
Mm-hmm.
Go like that, and it'll clean it.
So what do you think? Should we hire her to do this here every lunchtime?
For sure.
Yeah.
So it's a fun little thing, and like I said, you can flavor it a lot of different ways.
If they get like all around today, like
I'm gonna fish them. I'm gonna go fishing for you in 2 seconds. So then that's what I like to use this for. So I can actually go in here, and all the ones that have floated now for a minute, they're all ready to come out, and you'll see that they have. This is what I was talking about before, where you could actually make them to this stage and then pull them and leave them like this. And that's what I have. I prepared some this morning for you guys already for after this. Yeah, of course. So, and these are some of the ones that I made this morning, so you could see very similar. Nope. Yeah, and that's the great part about them. So if these, I didn't add anything to these, and if I go and I touch them, and actually, if you guys want to. Yeah.
They're not as pretty as yours.
Well, I have a little bit of practice. If you guys want to check these out, those are the ones that are made. And so they have a certain density to them, and a certain texture, but and you can, I mean, you can even eat them like that, but you'll see that they're pretty light. So this is a good chef trick. I'm gonna steal some of your seasoned cooking water.
So is this on the menu a lot at SPQR?
We have it on the menu with the lamb ragu right now. And we do different variations of this, you know, throughout the, but one of my favorite is to do just fresh out of the water, and then during truffle season, we just do truffles over that and Parmesan cheese, so it works good.
Amazing.
She's tenacious.
I know, she's, I think you should hire her.
I already did. Say fast.
How do you say that? I'm
all right, I won't
don't
say anything.
To him, yeah.
It's like my mom.
Wow. So now I add just a little bit of the cooking water here and some butter. I'm going to warm all these. And then we'll add in, I have some chopped tarragon and chopped parsley. And then we're going to do a few. We're going to use your nice gnocchis for the plate up today. Oh.
So what's the best advice a chef ever gave you, and who was it that gave it to you?
I've gotten so much advice. We call it feedback.
Feedback, okay.
Who knows? I mean, I feel like a good chef will give you advice every day. You know, give you, you know, I always tell my guys, you know, I see somebody. So last night I asked one of my cooks to take something upstairs and lay it out flat on a tray like this, and then come back. And so he went upstairs to get the tray to bring it down for the stuff so that he could then go back. So you just decided to make two trips for something that required one. Because if you do that 100 times a day, you will have just wasted an hour of your day running back and forth, getting nothing done. So if you apply that across your entire career at this point, that's a lot of wasted
that
time.
Is. It
so
adds up.
That little kind of stuff about, you know, is something that's constant.
Being efficient.
Good job.
Yeah.
Thank you. What's your name?
Katya,
thank you. Anybody else? I can refill this thing.
Anybody else want to try?
Yeah. Yeah, we print the menu every day, and I always liken it to the tracks of a caterpillar. So, you know, there's half of them are on the road and the other half are not. So there's probably 40 or 50 menu items, and then we're running 25 of those. So we're always coming up with new menu items. And then those new menu items, some are new, some were on 3 days ago and we bring them back. So, but we're always doing different things and bringing in a lot of what is important to me in the restaurant is things like pretty much all the animals that we buy, with the exception of beef, we buy whole. So that means if I get a duck, I'm gonna get, you know, duck fat and a duck terrine and duck breast and you know, duck legs and so all these different things. And then we use all the bones and we make broth. So that begets four or five dishes. But once we run out of duck breast, we're working with duck leg to do something else. And so there's always new dishes and always new things coming because of that sort of search for ingredients. Or if I go and, you know, all these onions are flowering right now, but in 2 weeks they won't be. So in 2 weeks, we couldn't even use that as an ingredient if we wanted to. So that kind of change in things.
Is there any new ingredient that you've discovered lately that you just love and can't get enough of?
It's hard to discover. I wish I could discover new ingredients more often than I do. But it was interesting because I went to this great trouble to get this certain type of ice lettuce or certain type of ice plant. And I had to go, and it was, I think I got it from a guy on eBay, and it was a little, you know.
A guy on eBay,
yeah, it was kind of
okay.
Sketchy, right?
Yeah.
And then I went around the corner from where I'm growing in Napa, and it's on somebody's lawn.
Oh, jeez.
And I was like, my God, you know, and it, somebody planted it as an ornamental, but it's edible. And so I kept thinking, well, I'm going to go back to that guy's yard in the middle of the night and cut that stuff. See, you're good. So, but I think, you know, you're always looking for new ingredients and new ways to use things. And I think that's also one of the great joys of being a chef is that you're bound to come back to stuff over and over again. Because every year corn comes and tomatoes come. And so yeah, I've started to actually consider tomatoes in the last 2 weeks. They're not really ready yet. But
everything's coming early this year.
Yeah. Yeah. But all of the tomatoes that I have growing are all starting to get there. So, but first we'll think about green tomatoes, and then we actually make a tomato leaf pasta
Wow.
So I asked one of my farmers one year to pick me 20 pounds of green tomatoes, and his guys picked 20 pounds of green tomato leaves.
Oh, no.
And they sent them to us, which I don't know if you, but 20 pounds is a lot.
Yeah.
So I kind of felt badly, and we had a long talk about it, and then eventually decided, you know, it'd be better to figure out what to do with these than throw them away. So that came out of that. But I think a lot of times that's another great thing is that, you know, a lot of times mistakes become the ideas. You know, if you learn something from a mistake, it becomes the next new idea. So looking for new uses or new ways to use an ingredient is just as beneficial as knowing what you did the year before and try and do something different based on that.
That's looking beautiful, by the way.
So.
We call them paradigms. So it's like, or adding something to the vernacular in my kitchen. So we'll have this thing and it's, wow, you know, I have this idea about, so we make lasagna. And so I can't make lasagna the way that everybody else makes lasagna. So I have to do this like 27 layer and we bake it in this special terrine mold that I had a stainless steel guy make for me. So that we can lift the mold off and then has all these layers. And so we've done that with all these different variations of the dough and the filling. But then at one point we wanted to do something different. And so I was like, all right, well, what is lasagna? Lasagna is this layered thing. What is lasagnette? And lasagnette is a thin lasagna noodle in Italy that is usually something that's eaten as a noodle pasta. And I don't know why they would call it lasagnette. But so I was like, all right, so what if lasagnette was a thin lasagna? And so we took this sheet of dough and we fill it and fold it and bake it. And right now we're doing one that's filled with ricotta and saffron. And it's a saffron dough and it looks like a little envelope. And then on top we do a mushroom bolognese with it. So those kind of things where you're just...
How long did it take you to perfect that?
A day.
A day? That's it?
Oh. But then what will happen from there is we'll change that lasagnette, the filling, the dough, the topping, all the different accompaniments, and it now has, good job.
Look at you, you're like a machine
and
over there.
And he needed zero supervision, by the way,
yeah,
if you guys know, pretty
notated
good.
That.
But now that'll be get 25 different iterations of that same idea. And so adding that new idea to the thing, like where at one point we buy a certain bread for the tables, and then as a restaurateur, even if you're buying bread for the tables, no one's, you know, we're talking about loaves of bread that nobody cuts. So we have it, we buy it for a day, nobody even asks to eat it. So you would just throw it away, because what am I gonna do with it the next day? But at some certain point, we're like, wow, what can we do? How can we not waste this product? Because as somebody lovingly prepared that product, so it, as a chef, you're really trying to make the best out of everything that you buy. We came up with this idea for what we call budino de pane, which is bread pudding. And so again, here it comes into play, this sort of mold like this, and we take brioche that we make and run it on a slicer, so you get these long planks of brioche dough, and put that in the bottom, take all these loaves, cut all of the crust off, use all of that, and right now we're doing it with apricots and white chocolate, and we make a white chocolate custard and soak that whole thing, put this layer of cubed bread in there, press it down and then take another layer of that brioche and put it on top. And we bake that whole thing. I had a plastic maker cut these perfect plastic weights so I could perfectly weigh the thing down.
Wow.
And we get this insanely perfect, huge block that we can then portion into bread puddings.
It's caramelized, like the most refined bread pudding
ever. Dip in sugar,
ever.
And then we, yeah. and then we caramelize it one more time, and it has a crunchy sugar exterior, like a creme brulee on a bread pudding that's made with that. But that's basically made out of what we would call trim for the interior part, which is bread that we didn't use from the day before. So those kind of things where you're always looking and trying to put innovation into something that you already have, that's those kind of new ideas is what's really important in a kitchen. So I'm always trying to instill that in the people that are working for me, because it's one thing to go and look for a completely brand new thing that you have to acquire, but what if you could do more with what you already have? And so that I think that's a really important concept for across, I think, a lot of disciplines, especially cooking. So. Regrettably, as you become a chef, it's more difficult, I would say. So I always say to the guy, you know, I have cooks that one day want to become a sous chef, and they say, well, chef, I've cooked for you for a couple of years. I'd like to become a sous chef and move up. And he say, I just want you to understand that the shift will go from where you're learning all the time to you're now learning a lot of the time, but you're also teaching a lot of your time. And then you get to the point where I'm at, and I spend more time teaching than I do learning. So it's really difficult for me to get. And actually, Google is a big help, right? because every time we're looking for, you know, if I have an idea, I can actually Google the ingredients and see, and you'll see what other stuff comes up. And then you try not to copy that or do those things, but it gives you some inspiration. And so I think in the real world where I'm doing that is, you know, I'm going and I'm spending a day here, or I'm going and I'm traveling and cooking with other chefs or doing other events and seeing what other people are doing. And you're trying to soak up the world around you to repurpose that experience for inspiration in your own realm, in your own kitchen. I think, but you know, it becomes certainly much more closed off the more you are the sort of chef in charge, right, at that point, because nobody's gonna come tell you, hey chef, I got this brand new recipe, I'm gonna give it to you, you know, for you to put in your cookbook. It's like, no, you better figure out your own stuff. So that's definitely an aspect of it.
So if you could choose to stage with any chef, living or dead, who would it be?
God, I don't know. I guess going back to that thing, I would have liked to have gone back to both of my grandmothers were incredible cooks, and I was too young and too foolish to know that I should have spent more time trying to figure out what they knew. And my grandmother actually gave me one of her cookbooks, which was like the, you know, Farmer's Almanac cookbook from the 40s. But she had made all of her recipes and all of her notes in that. And I had always, it was in my father's basement. It was destroyed in Hurricane Sandy.
Oh,
and it was the
God.
One thing that I was probably the most upset about losing. And we really tried, like, we stayed in a hotel room. We traveled there because I live here in California, obviously. So when that happened in New Jersey, in my father's house, we traveled and spent 3 days with hair dryers and irons and trying to dry stuff like that out. And it's just, whatever the water was, there was something not right. So we end up saying, this is like, got to get rid of it. But I tried to take pictures and sort of document what I could before we got rid of things. So, but it would have been a good experience to have spent that stuff. And, you know, like I said, it goes back to that third grade birthday party where I should have been paying a little more attention to the pizza, because I would have benefited. So this is another little handy tool. I don't know why it has a mirror. I would love it if sometimes somebody would tell me. I can't possibly figure it out, but it, you know.
So you can check your makeup, you know, in between.
I mean, is that, it makes no sense to me, but it seems an odd. So have you seen these before? You can get them like Daiso or one of those 99-cent stores.
Or
we go by
yeah.
Clement Street and buy them, and they're like $1. This is perfect for little a la minute garnishes. So this is just a little bit of truffle. So these are summer truffles, and usually they have a black exterior, and I really like to peel the outside off, and we use the outside and chop it up, and then we lightly cook this in mushroom stock. So a little bit of summer truffle, and then this is that black garlic puree to just finish it. So one thing that I could eat for the rest of my life? Cereal.
Cereal?
Yeah.
Any particular kinds?
Cereal and yogurt. No, we actually make granola at home. And I kind of hit the bulk bins at like Rainbow Grocery and Whole Foods and things. And then we'll use, you know, my girlfriend has a little bit of like a gluten thing that she's trying to work through. And so we were using like coconut sugar and maple syrup and all these other things to make different things and kind of experimenting with the different tastes. But I actually really like it. And we eat a lot of fruit, yogurt, and granola.
Wow, that's pretty healthy.
That's what it is. So, but this is what you guys made.
Pretty good, huh? So I know you still cycle a lot. In fact, you are doing a ride with Chef Chris Cosentino later this year.
I'm actually doing a couple different, so I'm still on the bicycle quite often. I'm going to Aspen Food and Wine because I have the Best New Chef Award this year, and so I will be riding from Leadville, Colorado, 70 miles over a mountain pass.
At high altitude.
Yeah, at 12,000 feet or something. So I'll be...
Have you done this before?
No.
Oh.
Gasping. Not recently. I haven't ridden over this pass before. So, but I think we start around 7,000 feet elevation and head up to 12 or 13,000 to get to Aspen Food and Wine. So there's a couple of pro cyclists and a few other riders that are coming that will certainly attempt to challenge me, I have no doubt. But then also in the fall, the Sonoma Century with Chris King, who is a bicycle component manufacturer, used to be based here in California, is now in Portland. So Chris Cosentino, myself, a chef from the Glen Ellen Star, and a few other people are going to be cooking for that. So I get to make lunch for 450 people. That should be fun.
So I know Chris also had dreams at one point of becoming a professional cyclist.
And he did, mountain bike race for a while.
He did, 24-hour ones too, yeah. So any rivalries there on the bike? Any side bets happening and who's going to win?
I think it's all friendly competition. Oh. So I think we'll all just have a good time. So, and I'm also headed to Greenville, South Carolina later this year for George Hincappy. Used to be... ride with Lance Armstrong on the Tour de France and all these other things. Now has his own company, Hincappy Sportswear, in Carolina, and he does a big ride every year. So I'll be going down there to cook and ride. And so I think, again, it's, you know, life is about trying to find the things that you love to do and get paid for it. So if get paid for doing them, you know. So if I can, you know, combine cycling and cooking together, that's the best of both worlds for me. So anytime I can do that, I'm fair game. You know, I'm game for it.
So before I let you guys all sample this, because we're going to have samples later, and we're also going to do a book signing afterwards, I always like to close the interview by doing a little fun word association with the chefs. So I'm going to say something, and I want you to answer with the first word or phrase or thought that comes into your head.
I can't wait.
Okay, you're a good sport. Chefs on social media.
Too much free time.
Restaurant critics.
Uh-oh.
The feeling of fresh pasta dough in your hands.
Supple.
Italian restaurants that can't be bothered with making their own pasta.
Lazy.
The James Beard Awards.
Prestigious.
The Tour de France.
Difficult.
Thomas Keller.
Hero.
Julia Child cooking shows.
Entertaining.
Lydia Bastianich.
Mama.
And last but not least, Chef Boyardee.
Do not open.
Oh! Well, thank you so much. If you guys have any questions, please jump in. Feel free.
Thank you.